Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi fi kulli lahadatin abada arda ni'amillahi wa afdalihi. Allahumma atina min ladunka rahmah wa 'allimna min ladunka 'ilma. Subhanaka la 'ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Nawaina ta'allama wa ta'lim wa tadhakkura wa tadhkir wa naf'a wa intifa' wa rifada wa istifada wa lahatha 'ala tamassuki bi kitabillahi wa sunnati rasulihi sallallahu 'alaihi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam wa du'a ila al-huda wa dalalah 'alal khair ibtigha'a wajhillahi wa mardatihi وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى مع لطف وعافية برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك العلم لدني والمشرب الصافي الهاني وهاب يا غني. اللهم إنا نسألك العلم لدني والمشرب الصافي الهاني يا وهاب يا غني. اللهم إنا نسألك العلم لدني والمشرب الصافي الهاني يا وهاب يا غني. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma alhimna 'ilman nufaqih bihi awamiraka wa nawahiyaka warzuqna fahman na'rifu bihi kayfa najika ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma inna nas'aluka fahman nabiyyin wa hifzal mursalin wa ilhamal malaikatil muqarrabin fi 'afiyatin ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma aghnina bil 'ilm وزينا بالحلم وأكرمنا بالتقوى وجملنا بالعافية يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم إنا نستودعك ما قرأناه وما نقرأه في هذا المجلس وما قبله وما بعده، فأحفظه علينا حتى ترده إلينا وقت احتياجنا إليه يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أكرمنا بالنور الفهم وأخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم، وافتح لنا أبواب رحمتك، وانشر علينا حكمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم يا من مقاليد الأمور كلها بيده وإليه يرجع الأمر كله، يا فتاح يا عليم، يا فتاح يا عليم، يا فتاح يا عليم، افتح علينا فتحا قريبا. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي وسدد لساني واهدي قلبي وافعل كذلك بأحبابي أبدا وارزقنا كمال فتوح العارفين والفقه في الدين مع كمال الإخلاص والصدق واليقين والعافية والغنى والنصر والحفظ والنفع والانتفاع وخيرة الدارين وعلوم الأولين والآخرين آمين. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين. الفاتحة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين آمين آمين. الحمد لله الحمد لله الحمد لله. Today we're going to continue with our we're going to begin proper we begin last week on our aqidah. So inshallah we were going to continue with where we left off from last week. And today inshallah from aqidah will be from 9:30 all the way until 10:15, 45 minutes. Per period is 45 minutes. Right, so at around 10:15, I will move on into fiqh. I'll go into fiqh. Right, so every one of these classes, I will always begin with the 10 foundations of every discipline, and we're gonna understand what these 10 foundations are all about. Right, now, okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Right, so last week I went through the poem on they speak about the 10 foundations and what are they, the definition, the topic, the fruits, the virtues, what it is related to, the founder, the name, where it was derived from, the legal ruling of it, and the issues it addresses, and Ishbak and then all of them actually come together to show a person what this knowledge is about. And last week we had questions, right, from some of you, that is to explain what is Aqidah all about. And these 10 foundations will cover everything. And in fact, if you go through the 10 foundations for every single subject that you come into with Islam, it will open up for you what the subjects are about. Right, so last week we went into the first part about the definition on Tawheed. Right, the word Tawheed in Arabic is from the word Wahada, Wahid, right? Wahid meaning one. Right, so it's from the word Wahada Yuwahidu Tawheed. Right, Wahada Yuwahidu Tawheed means to make something one. Right, to make something one. Right. So when we say the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is not that we are making Allah one. Allah is one, whether or not we realize it, but it is to make in our heads and to make in our hearts. Right. So to get ourselves to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. And He is one, right, by His by Himself. And we're gonna go into this attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An attribute, I might use it together with the word sifat, right? Sifat is an Arabic word, also a Malay word, but I always would attribute. And then if I were to say the word sifat, I will try to make sure I say the word attribute, right? Because I know they're amongst people here who are converts, right? And those who don't speak any Malay at all, right? So if I do say any word, probably it's an Arabic word, right? But the Malays took it as well, right? So I'll try my best to keep to English, mashallah. An English halaqa, and I also, my husband teaches also in English halaqa, and my husband does not speak any Malay at all. My husband is Tamil, and he speaks Tamil and English, and he told me that the people message him in Malay, and he has no clue what they're saying, you know, subhanAllah. And I get the same thing as well. People message me in Malay. I know Malay, but we're on an English halaqa. And so try to keep things English, right? Because there is a Malay halaqah that happens on Saturday. Right? So if you prefer Malay, there is a Malay halaqah that happens on Saturday. The Sunday one is English, right? So I'm going to try and be very, I'll try my best, right? To keep completely to English, because I know there are Chinese in this, there are people who are from a Chinese origin, right, in this class. There are those who are also Tamils, right? Indians who are here, right, who do not speak any Malay. Right? So we keep things formally and strictly English, inshallah, for the benefit of those who don't speak Malay. In my own family, there are 4 people who don't speak Malay: my father, my husband, and my sister, and I have 2 in-laws who don't speak Malay. They're non-Malays, right? So I know that how they feel when people, just because they wear the hijab, they begin speaking to them in Malay, and my sister-in-law's like, I have no idea what they're saying. She's Chinese, she's no idea what they're saying. Subhanallah. Right, so mashallah, I'm just going to say that the sifat, I was going to talk about the word sifat. Right, sifat is an Arabic word. Right, it means attributes. Right, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right, to understand the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the oneness in the that, right, in the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're going to go into deeper into that as we go into our book. The oneness of Allah's actions, right, the af'al. The af'al, the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that it's all one and the same, right? Because Allah does not live in a time frame, right? We all live in time frames. Allah does not live in a time frame. Allah created time subhanahu wa ta'ala, so He's not bound by time. And we are unable to understand or to grasp this because all we know of our experience is time. Like we have never experienced a timelessness. Like maybe the closest what we can understand to timelessness is our dreams. When we dream, all kinds of things happen, right? So spatial dimension and time dimension, they don't exist in our dreams. Right? It all kinds of random things, you know, happen here and there, and there's no reference point, you know, subhanAllah. Right? So by the religion, the word Tawheed, it is a knowledge by which firmness in religious beliefs and undisputable certainty based on, by which firmness in religious beliefs and undisputable certainty come about based on truth, based on proofs is known, right? By which all of these things are known. So to know that Allah is the creator, to know about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to know about the prophets being prophets, and to know the attributes of prophets as well, right? And this all comes on proofs. They are not just because someone told you. It comes from proofs and from logical reasoning that a human being can come to these realizations. Right? Why is that necessary? Because we're looking at, for example, if a person was not a Muslim, how do they come into Islam? Right? So you can't say to the person, believe what the Quran says. They have not believed yet. So they have to come into it. And the Quran itself teaches human beings how to think. Right? And how do you come to a truth that is undisputable, right? That is, and how do you come to a certainty, right? That cannot be negated. You know, subhanAllah, this is the aqidah of Islam. And that's why I mentioned that the one thing I love about studying aqidah is that you can go so deep into aqidah. Aqidah is our belief system. You can go so deep into aqidah, you're just going to see it being more and more and more perfect. You see the perfection manifest itself. You know, subhanAllah, the deeper you go, the more mind-blown you are by this, that it's impossible for anyone to walk away from this unless it is their nafs or it is their desires that have come into play. Like, no one has left Islam based on firm and correct understanding of aqidah. It has never happened. Right? But if they were to leave Islam, it is because of a misunderstanding of the aqidah of Islam or because of their desires. The desires don't want to submit to the Sharia, to the laws of Islam. Yes, I admit the laws of Islam, and we all know the laws of Islam, it can be heavy. Right? It can be heavy on an individual. Right? But it's why, mashallah, I have friends who are, when I was studying in Tarim, I have friends who were converts. You know, I have one very, very close friend of mine from England, you know, and she's a convert, and she's been like 15 years convert. And she told me that it is really very true that the aqidah makes so much sense. You study the aqidah, you go into what we believe in, you go into what Allah says, you go into all these things. It makes so much sense. It's just obvious. And so she said to say the shahada, and she was, this friend of mine, she was previously Hindu, and she, living in the UK. Then when she heard her conversion story was that she was living in a university, and she had a Muslim roommate in the university. And she used to bring her idols, the small, she had like, you know, Hindu idols, and they were small Hindu idols. And she used to bring them into her dorm room, right, that she shared with a Muslim, you know, and she would pray to her Hindu idols. Right? And the Muslims who were there, you know, they were quite vocal and they kept asking her questions. Right? They were not criticizing, but they were asking her questions about her idols. And she told me that she became very defensive, you know, about it. These Muslims keep asking about my idols, right? And then and she became more and more defensive about it. But after a while, a lot of conversation with her Muslim dorm mates, you know, she began to reject the idea of idolatry. It was very easy. She told me it was so easy for her to just reject it, right? Because it didn't make any sense. Right? So she rejected it. But it took her. But she was still resistant, you know, to go and study Islam. But you know, she was drawn. She was drawn to how her Muslim dorm mate, you know, how they were. So she began to study the aqidah of Islam, the belief system of Islam. And then she said to me, it just made so much sense. It was so logical. It made so much sense. That she had no choice but to come into Islam, to be true to herself. She had to come into Islam and to be true to herself, even though she knew the repercussions of doing so, because she is originally from India. She lives in the UK, but originally from India, and the dynamics between the Hindus and the Muslims in India, right? Especially for someone who's from India, like it's really a lot of friction. It's a terrible. I mean, the dynamics is terrible between the Muslims, you know, and the Hindus in India. So she knew if she entered into Islam, it would be like she would be throwing herself to the slaughter in her family, and her family will never accept it, right, because of their hatred against Muslims. Right, so she told me her story, a long story, that mashallah. Right, but she did tell me one thing. She said that when she entered into Islam, the aqidah was so easy. It was really natural to embrace this aqidah. It was the soul knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the soul knows this is truth. But she said, then you get hit, like you get whammed with the train of the Sharia. And she said, that is like all of a sudden,
5 times a day praying, then fasting a whole month of Ramadan, and then, you know, putting on the hijab, and then, you know, she was like, it's like one thing after another, and halal food, and no, and then she said halal food thing was a bit easier for her because she was a vegetarian anyway, right? But was like so many things, you know, coming in at one go. The Sharia of Islam, can be overwhelming, and if someone is not used to it, you know, especially praying 5 times a day. If you're not used to it, it can be overwhelming on the person. But may Allah give us strength. Inshallah, may Allah give us strength. Inshallah. Right. So it so we understand, right? What is the aqidah of Islam? Right. It is a knowledge by which firmness in religious beliefs and undisputable certainty based on proofs is known. Okay. Number two, the topic. What are we studying? We are studying the essence of Allah, the that of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the angle of what are the attributes that are necessary, what are impossible in His right, and what is possible but not necessary in His right. Right, that's the first thing. The essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is called the that. Right, the that. What do we mean by the that or the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We mean that Allah is a being who is real. Right? Allah is real. Right, so Allah is not made of a substance. Like when I speak about my reality, like what do I say about my reality? Do I just say about this skin that is made of cells and carbon? Right, do I just speak about that? I said no. That's not all I am. I'm also a soul that's in me. It's a soul in me. That's who I am. I am this physical body. Yes, I'm also made up of a soul. I have a soul, and I also have a mind. The mind is different from the soul. They're different. Where's my mind? I lost my mind. Yeah, but I don't know. But my mind is somewhere. It's not in my head. My mind is in me somewhere. I don't know where. But I know I have a mind. Emotions. I have emotions. They're somewhere in my heart, I think. I also think it's somewhere. Right? The emotions are somewhere, you know, inside of me. I am made up of many different layers of things. That is my reality. That's what I am, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't speak about a physical body. We don't speak about a soul. We don't speak about emotions. We don't speak about a mind, right? Because Allah is not like His creation. And Allah is impossible for Allah to be like His creation. So whatever we understand of ourselves, we know for sure Allah is not that. For sure. Allah is not how we are, right? So even when we say about direction, you know, where am I? I'm in front of you. I'm behind you. I'm you know, on your right, on your left. I can be above, I can be below, right? So we don't say Allah is above in a direction. No, right? If in fact it's also wrong to say Allah is everywhere. It's also wrong to say that, because everywhere refers to a place. Allah does not exist within a place. Allah does not need a place to exist in. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah created places. Right? So to say Allah is everywhere itself is a wrong statement. It's a wrong statement. You say Allah sees me everywhere I go. Yes, it's correct. Right? Allah sees me everywhere I go. So we need to rephrase how we speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Allah knows whatever I do everywhere I am. No, wherever I am, Allah is with me. Yes, I can say that. But you can't say Allah is everywhere. That's not a correct statement. That He is everywhere. He's not everywhere. He sees you wherever you go. He's not where. You can't say where for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't say that because Allah is not like His creation. So what do we say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We say Allah's essence. Essence. Right? What is His essence? Only Allah knows what it is. Nobody knows. Because if you were to know what it is, that means that you are referring to something of your experience in Allah's creation to equate to Allah's essence, which is not possible because Allah is not like His creation. Which is why you can never know about Allah's essence, because all we know is Allah's creation. That's all we know. We don't know what is beyond this creation. Correct? Right? So if, let's say, to give an example, if I were to ask you, you know, can you imagine a color that you have never seen? Can you possibly imagine a color that you have never seen? You're like, no. Every color that you can imagine has to be related to something that you have ever seen. Correct? You can't imagine a color that you've never seen. You can't. it has to be something within your understanding, right? It has to be something within your understanding of what you have seen. So which is why we can never understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because what Allah is, the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is nothing to do with our experience on this earth, but our observation of Allah's creation. Now all of these things point logically to that there has to be a creator. Right? And the belief in the creator is based on sound, a sound reasoning and proofs. Unlike the disbelief in the creator. Like if you ever read books on atheists, because for me, I like to read all this kind of stuff. So when I read all these books by atheists, right? They actually have no logical reasoning. They actually have no logical reasoning. If you go into all of their books and how they argue the God delusion lah, and tawa benda lah, I mean all of these things, right? They talk about, you know, all this. They talk about all these things, but if you read into it, they actually have no proof, right? And what they keep saying is that just because they can't keep saying it because they can't prove God with their limited selves, therefore He does not exist. And that's the most illogical reasoning. It is the most illogical way to reason. Because just because you can't prove something does not mean it doesn't exist. You know, if I was to live here in Singapore and if there's some town somewhere in Alaska that I can't prove for it to exist, does it mean that it doesn't exist? Of course not. It just means that I can't prove its existence because of my limitations. Right? No way can someone say, just because I can't prove something exists, therefore it does not exist. It's not logic. It's completely illogical. And you can bring any example in our experience to prove against it. You know, subhanAllah. But that's how the atheists speak. That's how the atheists speak. So the creationists, because we're talking about akidah, mashallah, is that my favorite topic. You go in between the atheists and the creationists. This is called Islamic theology. Now, if you're wondering, you know, that it's called ilmu kalam in Arabic, ilmu kalam. It's deep. If you think it is so deep, it is deep. Akidah is deep, and it forces you to go into depth. It forces you because it is your belief system. Right? Your belief system cannot be shallow. If it's shallow, someone comes along and attacks it, it crumbles. Right? It crumbles, it collapses, and then what do you believe in? Right? So you can't say that, you know, I don't want to go deep into akidah, I don't want to learn akidah. You know, it's enough for me. You know, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Inshallah, enough for us. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what if someone comes up to you and begins to ask you questions? You don't want to be that person who's shaking, you know, and unable to answer questions. You know, or that person who's bothered by all this, you know, talk online. And maybe not you, maybe your children, maybe the young ones in your family. What if they come up to you and begin to ask you questions and you don't know how to handle these questions? So learning aqidah is fardu ain. Right? It's fardu ain. It is compulsory on every Muslim to go into depth, not into all the way depth, but some depth, right? To be strong in what they believe in. And mashallah. Right, so Allah's essence, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the angle, this is not in your book, it's all my own slides. Right? From the angle of what are the attributes that are necessary, what are impossible in His right, and what is possible but not necessary. Right, so His 20 attributes that are necessary for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're going to go into that in a while. So this is our topic for Aqidah. We're going to learn as to what is wajib, what is necessary in the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as how we understand God to be. Subhanallah, and then what is impossible in the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so we understand God to is impossible for God to be, and then what is possible for God to do or to be that is in His right. We also learn in Aqidah the essence of prophets, who are prophets and what are prophets, and we learn that prophets are human beings. So we'll never, ever, ever elevate a prophet. It's not elevate, but it's basically a slander, a prophet, into putting him on the pedestal of divinity. We can never do that, right? Because prophets are human beings. Right? So it is a slander against a prophet to say the prophet is divine, to say the prophet is God, to say the prophet is son of God, is a slander. In our Aqidah, it's slander, right? Against a prophet. In Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah will never allow for anyone to put Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on a divine pedestal. Right? So no matter what Muslims, no matter what Muslims, still from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam till now, you'll never find any group of Muslims that pray to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You will not find this, right? Because Allah will not allow for it. It will never happen till the day of judgment. Nobody, as much as we love him and we revere him and we admire him, you know, and we praise him, nobody from his time to our time has ever prayed to him. Nobody. Allah will not allow for that to happen, right? Because that would severely displease our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if somebody were to place him as someone divine, right? But he's not. He is Abdullah, right? He is a servant, a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So from the angle of what are the attributes that are necessary, what are impossible in their right, and what is possible but are not necessary in their right, we're going to go through all of this, inshallah, in our class. Matters that we hear about but we do not see. So the topic of Aqidah, we're going to speak about matters that we hear about but do not see. These are called the Sama'iyat. In Arabic, they call it Sama'iyat. Meaning we hear about these things but we'll never see them until they actually happen. For example, angels. Right, for example, Day of Judgment. We hear about the Day of Judgment, we never see it. Unless you have a dream about the Day of Judgment. Right, but you never see the Day of Judgment. We hear about heaven and hell, we never see heaven and hell. Right, so there are things that we hear about all the time as Muslims. In fact, all the time, you hear about shaitan, you hear about, you know, our skills of goodness and bad deeds. We hear about the angels on our shoulders. We never see any of these things. We just hear about them. But what makes us believe them? That is Aqidah. And what makes us believe these things are real? And these are the ultimate realities, in fact. And these things are ultimately real. Because our whole life will come down to what Allah says in the Quran, يَوْمُ الطَّامَّةِ فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الطَّامَّةُ الْكُبْرَى. In Surah Nazi'at, Allah says, what is طَامَّةِ? طَامَّةِ it refers to an event that everything will collapse into at the Day of Judgment. All of this creation will collapse into that one event. Everybody will meet at that one meeting place, the Day of Judgment. Right, so we know about these things, we hear about them, right? But what are the proofs, and how do we come into this strong belief these things are real? And this is important as for Muslims to go through and to teach our own family, our own children, because at the end of the day, our actions are governed by our beliefs. Now, if you believe every word that you say can be questioned, you know, about on a Day of Judgment, you will never lie. Like, you will never lie, you will never slander, you will never cheat, because you believe every word is going to be questioned on the Day of Judgment. You know, subhanAllah, you believe, if you believe every second of your time will be questioned on the Day of Judgment, how you spend your time, then are you going to continue wasting time? If you believe how many years has been written for you on this earth, and when you die, you go into another world of the graves, because the barzakh, or the world of the graves, is also something that we hear about, we don't see. We know there's a world of the graves. We know that. When Rasulullah said in a hadith that when a person, he said in a hadith that the grave, it is either a pit from the pits of the fire or a garden from the gardens of paradise. You choose what your grave is going to be. Right, so can you imagine, you know, that if someone knows that their grave is going to be either a pit from the pits of the fire or garden of paradise, then they would, for example, they would never leave reciting Surah Muluk, because Surah Muluk prevents punishment in the grave. They would never leave it because they are firm and they understand that I don't want to be punished in my grave. Now they understand that. If someone understands that, you know, that there's a serpent that comes to the grave, from the hadith, the serpent that comes to the grave every prayer time. And if this person in the grave had not prayed that prayer, the serpent will punish that person until the next prayer time. If you have a belief in that, Like, you would never miss your prayer. That's how my mother brought us up when I was young. And she would tell us about the serpent. And it's true. There's a hadith about it. There's a serpent that comes to you every time, every prayer time. And if you had prayed the prayer, the serpent will go away. If you had not prayed the prayer, the serpent will punish you for not praying the prayer. You know, subhanAllah, is all, so why we think matters we hear about, we don't see. And these are things that are important because human beings, they need incentives. And human beings, we need threats. That's how we work. Incentives and threats. That's how we work, right? You work with any child, you will see, if not only child, adult. Adult also same thing. You give an incentive or you give a threat, right? And you get them to get up and do some work. You know, subhanAllah. The fruits of this knowledge, this is what we just spoke about, eh? The fruit of this knowledge is a knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the clear, distinguished proofs. And this will lead us to success in the eternal abode of bliss. This is the highest knowledge any individual can spend time on. The knowledge of Aqidah is the highest knowledge, inshallah. Okay. The virtue of this knowledge. This knowledge is the most noble, I just mentioned that, the most noble knowledge because it is connected to understanding the Creator. Who is our Creator? The Creator of the heavens and the earth and the prophets. Hence, it is the foundation to all other knowledges. Right? Every knowledge in Islam will find its way back to Aqidah. Right? It is the foundation and all other knowledges will stem out of Aqidah. And that is the fault, you know, of some ways of teaching, that they impose the Sharia before establishing the Aqidah. And Sharia meaning Islamic law. That's a fault if someone has done that. It's a fault and it is oppressive if someone has done that. Someone who has forced a person into the laws of Islam without giving them an understanding of what do we believe in Islam. Because once you have established the belief system, obedience is easy. You know, or maybe not easy, but obedience is, you know, like that you will feel more drive to obey. You know, how many people, you know, they force their children into the laws of Islam without ever explaining to their children who is Allah? What is this world about? What is the next world about? Who is the Prophet? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No explanation of all these things or hardly any talk about all these things. And then all of a sudden, pray. Otherwise, I will cane you. You know, put on the hijab. Otherwise, I will beat you. Put on the fourth. These are the laws of Islam, yes. But laws of Islam is based on a foundation of belief. And when they believe, they have a creator that they need to show thanks to. They need to be grateful for. And all grateful towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe they have a prophet who loves them and who has shown them the best way to live this life. And when you believe all these things, then when the laws come, someone says to you, this is sunnah, right? This is wajib, this is haram, this is makruh. Straight away you listen. Why? Because you believe in Allah and His Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? So it is an injustice for someone to force the law without explaining who are we obeying. And that's once I spoke to, I used to have a convert circle, and I was speaking to one of them, and she was saying, you know, she's being taught how to pray and forced to pray, but she's no idea who she's praying to. It was never explained to her. She was just forced to enter into Islam, you know, because of marriage, right? But it was never explained to her who she's praying to. Who is she praying to? So I went through with her Aqidah. I had to go through with her Aqidah. And then she she asked, and who is this Muhammad? You know, who is he? Is he someone completely foreign? He's an Arab man who lived in the 6th century, right? A long time, an ancient Arab man. Nabi Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you've not been growing up, if you never grew up on knowledge of him, you would be, you know, you don't know how to interact with the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why it has to be taught. And you have to be taken by the hand and go through this, especially those who are new. And those who are new include not just converts, but children. And also Muslims who have come back to the path and they want to get it right with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They've been astray for so long. and they want to come back, they tawbah, they repent, they want to come back, right? So now what do? You have to speak to them about aqidah. Speak to them about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is the foundation to all other knowledges, and all other knowledges will collapse if the aqidah is not sound. If the aqidah is not firm, all other knowledges will collapse in itself. Its connection to other knowledges, it is a knowledge by itself by which a person's belief rests on. It is the foundation of every other knowledge in Islam, as we mentioned earlier on, right? So but it is a knowledge of by itself, so it's not dependent on other knowledges. It's a knowledge by itself, right? But all other knowledges depend on it. The founder of this knowledge, so of course it is every prophet. Right. So you want to think about, when you want to speak about the human being, the first human being who spoke about aqidah, every prophet, of course. Right? Because aqidah is truth. It is reality. And truth, by the very definition of truth, there is no beginning to truth. Truth does not have a beginning. It cannot have a beginning. Truth. Because if something is truth, it has to be there all the while. Right? If there was a beginning to truth, then what do you say about the time before the truth began? Is that untruth? You get what I'm saying? Right? This is one of the arguments. I had a friend who converted, you know, from Christianity into Islam, and she said that, you know, when they speak about Jesus, you know, and they speak about, and because this is a Muslim class, okay, we're in masjid, right? So we're allowed to explore the aqidah of other religions. We're not, you know, trying to create discord or whatsoever in society, but basically exploring the aqidah that's going on out there. But anyway, this Christian convert, she came to Islam, she said to me, right, that, just to expand our understanding, she said that, you know, she actually asked this one question, right, to her priest, you know, that if Jesus, you know, if Jesus is a savior, you know, for all the sins of human beings, then, you know, and he was born, when he was born, right, by Mary, Siddha Maryam, then people before Jesus, were they calling onto Jesus? Or were they calling onto someone else? So she basically what had happened to her was that there was a clash, right? That if Jesus is God or the Son of God, he had a beginning. He was born at a particular time. Then those before him, who were they praying to? That was the question. Who were they praying to? Right? And because as Christians, they know there are prophets before Nabi Isa alayhi salam. There were prophets before. And they know of Nabi Ibrahim, called Abraham, calling onto God. Was Abraham calling onto Jesus? She had this kind of, she was confused. Because it's not truth. It's not truth. Right? Truth doesn't have a beginning. Truth is there forever. Forever truth is there. There is no beginning for truth. And there cannot be a beginning for truth. Because if truth had a beginning, then what happened before the beginning of truth is called what? Was that truth? You know, subhanAllah. So the aqidah, it has been there and it's unchanged. And truth cannot change as well. Truth is unchanging. It has to be the same from forever infinity, from beginning forever infinity to forever infinity. You know, it's the same the entire time, because Allah does not change. Allah has no beginning, Allah has no end, Allah does not change. So truth, ultimate truth of this entire existence cannot change. Right? So it can't be that people of long ago didn't know about the Day of Judgment. And then now we know about the Day of Judgment. It can't be that. Right? It can't be. Right? Because that would be unfair to the people of long ago. Wouldn't that be the case? Then if you say that, my friend who converted from Christianity said that now they say we have to accept Jesus as our Savior, you know, and the Son of God. Now, what about people from before? What about them? You know, before Jesus. How does that work? You know, subhanAllah. So when we see aqidah, from the very first prophet, from the very first human being, right, the very first human being spoke about it, right, and they thought about Allah through revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and every prophet would say the same thing. Every prophet from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from Nabi Muhammad, Nabi Adam alayhi salam, all the way to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, every prophet said the same thing. However, here you see two names, right? As they are the founders of the Aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And I'm going to explain a little bit about this because it's important for us to understand. Because especially if someone were to say to you, you know, are you following Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah? And you're like, I don't know. Right? Or they ask, what is Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah? And you're like, I don't know, but I know I am part of it. All of you here are part of it. Okay, all of you here, you're part of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. If you're here at Masjid Khalid, you are part of it, of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Right? So why is Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah? Okay, so Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, it is because, a bit of history, right? It is because in the history of Islam, right, there have been people or groups of people, right, who spoiled the belief system in Islam, right? It has happened in the history of Islam and it's ongoing till today. It has happened and it's ongoing till today, right? So, and one part of, you see, it's very close to the time of Rasulullah Islam, only 3 centuries after Hijrah. It's very, very close. Right? So, Imam Abu Hazm al-Ash'ari and Imam Abu Mansur al-Maturidi. We follow them. We follow their Aqidah that they have penned down. So basically what has happened? What happened was that the time of the Khawarij, and I'm going to throw some names out right now with the regards to Islamic history, right? There were two groups and two timings, the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila. Okay, Khawarij and Mu'tazila. Okay, they were somewhat on the same, you know, line of what they were saying. So they were saying things like, they were ascribing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala physicality, right? They were doing that, right? And they were taking verses in the Quran to be literal when it was never understood to be literal. For example, when in the Quran Allah says about Allah's istiwa, you know, that Allah rises to the throne, right? And Allah rests on his throne. So automatically, as Muslims, we know that does not carry a literal meaning. It's impossible for that to carry a literal meaning. How can a creation and the throne of Allah, the arsh, the throne of Allah is creation nonetheless, right? Jannah is creation. Hell is creation. They're all creation. And only one creator. Everything else is creation. Allah's throne is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can Allah be on his creation? Doesn't make sense. Right, how can Allah be on his own creation? How can Allah be on? That gives spatial dimension. And we have spatial dimension. Allah is nothing like us. So there cannot be a spatial dimension or direction to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what had happened in the past was that Muslims, they began to go into these verses that are understood to be figurative. They are figurative verses. So when you say Allah's, you know, Allah descends the lowest heaven every night, you know, any answers to the du'as of those who are making du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't ever understand it to be physical. So we throw out the entire physical understanding because it's not possible for Allah to be physical. But there is a figurative understanding that means Allah is closest to you. So it's not that he's physically there. He's closest to you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah is on his throne, what it means is that Allah's power is over his entire creation. Now, Allah's power. When we say about the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we speak about the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see that? And when you speak about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because love is emotion. When you speak about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we speak about the mercy. And what are we referring to when you say love? Because love for human beings is inclination. That's love, right? Love is inclination. Love is sacrifice. Correct? That's how you a human being might very simply define love. To be inclined to someone, right, or to something, and to sacrifice at all that you have for that thing. Does God incline? Can God incline? You know, because inclination is on the side of weakness. There's a weakness to it, right? If inclination, then you tend to do things for the beloved. There's a weakness there. And then to sacrifice means to give up of your rights. You can't say that about God, because God is all powerful. Right? He is greater than everything. You can't say that about God. So now what do we mean by Allah loves? What do you mean by Allah loves? That means Allah's rahmah, Allah's mercy descends on the individual. Allah loves so-and-so, it means Allah's mercy is on so-and-so. Meaning Allah will not punish so-and-so. Meaning Allah will give them of the greatest gifts in paradise. That is what we mean by mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See how what happens, right? So it's very easy for people who have not studied, you know, to actually fall into giving spatial or physical dimension or creation understanding to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why Surah Ikhlas is called Surah Ikhlas. Surah Ikhlas, Qul huwallahu ahad. It's called Surah Ikhlas because Surah Ikhlas cleanses the heart of any misunderstanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what Surah Ikhlas does to us. The more you read Surah Ikhlas, the more your heart is cleansed of any misunderstanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unless you don't even realize you're actually holding misunderstandings. You don't even realize it, that we actually have misunderstandings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until someone mentions it to us, and we're like, oh yeah, I always thought it to be that way. In the subhanallah. Right, so Imam Al-Ash'ari and Imam Al-Maturidi, what they did was that they structured Aqidah learning. They structured the science. So they're not the founder of the science, because the science has always been there from the very first prophet, you know, who taught it. But these imams, they put it into structure for people to learn systematically. So you know where to start, where to end, right? In the studying of this science. You see that, you see that. So in fact, you know, many things in Islam, right, the founder would be the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like for example, the study of Quran, who's the founder? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there are scholars who actually structured it. They just put it into structure for systematic learning, which is very important for you to be able to progress. Same thing with fiqh, sharia. So the sharia, laws of Islam, who is the founder? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? He's the one who taught us sharia. But we say Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Ash-Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, right? They put it into structure for people to be able to follow effectively. So they are the ones who founded the structure, right? But the science itself is all from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, let me just continue this, and then I will take a short break after going through this. So the name of this science, it can be called Aqidah, it can be called Tawheed, it can be called Usuluddin, it can be called Ilmu Kalam. Right? Usuluddin means the foundations of the religion. Okay, Usuluddin means the foundations of the religion. So someone said, I study Usul. Right? That means they are studying Aqidah. Aqidah. Ilmu Kalam, also, as I said just now, is one of the names of Aqidah. They're all used interchangeably, more or less. Right, is derived from proofs from the mind, right? From, as I said, from logic, right? From the mind, as well as revealed texts. Right? So after someone has come into belief, your belief is further strengthened by the Quran and by the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number 9, the legal ruling in studying this knowledge. What is the ruling that I have to come to this knowledge? The ruling is, it is fardu ain, meaning it is compulsory on every legally responsible person. Legally responsible person is called a mukallaf. If you ever seen the word before, it's called a mukallaf. And what is a mukallaf? It means baligh aqil. Baligh aqil means has reached puberty. And baligh meaning reached puberty. And aqil, having a sound mind, right? So someone who has not reached puberty, they are not held legally responsible. Legally meaning in the sharia, and legally, right, in the Islamic law, right, in Islamic law. Okay, so legally responsible. So all of you here, you all are mukallaf, right? Mukallaf meaning that you have reached puberty and you have sound minds. Right? So someone who's not included is someone is a child or an adult who does not have a sound mind. Right? So for example, a severely autistic adult, right? So they're unable to grasp, right? So they're not held accountable. Right? But for all of you here, you all are under this category of the mukallaf. It is compulsory, male or female, to know what is necessary, what is impossible, and what is possible in the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His prophets. It is fardu kifaya. Right? What is fardu kifaya? Fardu ain means compulsory on every person, right? Fardu kifaya means some people in the community need to learn it. Right? So for deeper knowledges on aqidah, right, some people need to learn it, not everybody. So the primary knowledge, right, the first level knowledge, fardu ain, that what we're learning here in Masjid Khalid is fardu ain. Everybody must learn this, right? Fardu kifaya is going deeper, right, into the entire, you know, theology, into the entire, it goes deep into all kinds of issues lah, right? So only some of the ulama, some of the scholars, some of, you know, the asatiza, of the teachers, who will learn this. There are people who specializes. They will specialize in this. I know, mashallah. Right, for deeper knowledges on Aqidah, to be able to reject disbelief, innovation, and any falsity. Right, so some people will have to be masters in this, so they can contend, right, or they can reject, right, those who make up falsities about this. The issues it discusses, it will discuss the integrals of Iman, of what is necessary, what is impossible, and what is possible and necessary, and responding to wrong ideologies and statements. This is what we will discuss in the knowledge of Aqidah. Alright. Okay. Are there any questions? Okay. If there are no questions... There are no questions. We'll take a 2 minutes break. Now you can go and like take some water or stretch or something. Then we'll come back and continue the fiqh. So I'm done with my slides here. The next lesson, I will go into the book. So I hope you all have the book, Lessons in Divine Unity. You should get the book from the masjid. So next week, I think you all are on at masjid. You all are at site. No. You all on site when? First week of February, I think. Right? You all on site when? Yeah. Okay. Someone asked a question. Allah cannot be like His creation in His zat. What about His sifat? Right? A parent is compassionate to her child. Allah is more compassionate. Okay. Good question. Right? So Allah, even in His sifat, He's not like His creation. All we understand about His sifat is the word compassionate. Right? So we understand how it is for us to be compassionate to our children. Allah's compassion, we will say it is nothing like our compassion. Right? It is beyond us. It's beyond us. So we understand something of it. Like we understand like how we understand existence. We know we exist and Allah exists. But His existence is not like our existence. Like we know we see and Allah sees. But His seeing is not like our seeing. So we know the word. We share the word with us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's something else. It's something else. Like we don't know. Now the day of judgment we're gonna see lah, inshallah. Inshallah, the day of judgment. So someone asked a question. Let me see, a few more questions. No, a lot of questions. Okay, how do you know that you have fulfilled the obligation to learn Aqidah? How in depth must you learn this topic? Basically, if you have covered this book, you have this book and the next book, Al Kharida. Kharida, which you learn in Masjid Khalid, that is the minimum, right? The minimum of what you have to learn about Aqidah, right? So beyond that is yeah. Right? So basically, actually, in fact, this book that you're going through, that is a minimum already in itself. It's a minimum. If someone asks the question, where is Allah? Can I confirm it is wrong to ask that question? There is no answer to that question, lah. Where is Allah? There's no awareness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't say where. You say Allah exists. And Allah exists. Right? So, because you can't say, because when I teach the children, on Saturdays I teach the kids, I will say to them, like, is Allah in paradise? Some of them will say yes. So yeah, Allah is in paradise. Allah is in Jannah. And then I will say, did Allah create paradise? Yeah, Allah created paradise. And then how can Allah be in paradise? Then they will stop. Allah's not in paradise. Right? And then eventually you come to a point where you say, can Allah be in anything? Can Allah be in something? Then they'll say, no, cannot. It cannot happen. Then what do we say? Allah is Allah. That's all we say. Allah is Allah. Full stop. And that's all we say. Okay, the question here, someone asked my daughter, why should we be afraid of Allah? Right? Why should we be afraid of Allah? Okay, the word afraid here, when you feel afraid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right, is the same meaning as when you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you love a person. You can always draw parables. You know, of course, Allah is above all parables, but you can draw parables to try and get the understanding to be closer. Right, so you see, like, you know, like how you love, you know, your parents, you love your father, you love your mother, like you are afraid that you are afraid to make them angry with you. It is a fear born out of love. It's a fear born out of love, right? So you are afraid to have them angry with you. You're very afraid to make them disappointed in you, right? You're even more afraid if they turned away from you. And so all fears, because you, like, for, as a child, they need their parents, especially so, right? They need them. We all need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need His guidance. We need His mercy. We need His sustenance. And so we are afraid that by our own disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I'm distanced from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a fear. So you can always draw a parable with someone that you love. Are you afraid that if you keep, you know, hurting someone, or you keep disobeying someone, that they distance from you? You know, and you're afraid that happens, right? Because you love that person. You see that? And of course, Allah is our ultimate love. Right? So the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is born out of the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right, so you can reply to your children, yes, Allah exists. He sees us everywhere. Right, Allah exists. He is with you wherever you go. You can say that. Yes, He is with you. Because that's from the hadith. Allah is with you wherever you go. You can say that. Okay, mashallah. Okay, alhamdulillah. Let me just... Okay, this is the book you all should be having. So the masjid should be giving to you all.